check out my new EL6 Super Fresh Dope Space Age Mixtape. Booyah!
Oh, yeah. Welcome to the very first episode of the Space Age Mixtape. I'm your host, Roman Cortez. And the date today is October 17th, 2023. We are in the beautiful location of Irvine. Irvine, right? Yeah, Irvine. All right. So today's guest is... I've known you for 26 years. Can you believe that?
I think longer than that.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oops. I turned you off. 26, 97. I met you in 97.
No.
Yeah. So he is the head of J3 Productions, which is a multidisciplinary creative and consulting studio in the OC. He runs the Happy Mundane Instagram with over 100,000 followers. You also have, and which I just checked, you still post on Pinterest, where you still have over 1 million followers. It's 1 million something. You also do the, well, I don't know if you're still doing it, the quarterly, the J3 zine at your leisure.
No.
Oh. And you also have the Octopian, which is like a bi-yearly or yearly mag.
Yearly, this point.
Yeah.
That's what the zine turned into.
And I wrote down that you're an avid vintage knickknack collector.
Yes.
And coming to the studio, I could see that you're still collecting.
Yes.
Yeah. And please welcome the very creative Jonathan Lowe. Give it up. Listen to that crowd. They're so happy. And then, I don't know, what do you consider yourself? What's your title? What do you think? Like for myself, I just say artist now.
Really?
Yeah, just, there's too much. Not that I'm doing too much, but it's just
I think you're easier. More of an artist than I am.
Yeah. But what do you think? Designer?
Designer? Creative? I guess creative.
Just a creative dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. At this point, yeah.
Designer is usually a nice, more acceptable, easily understandable.
Yeah, when you talk to people like, oh, but do whenever you say designer, do they say like, oh,
yeah,
design?
Yeah, there's that. Yeah. But at least it's like, I don't know, it's or I'll just say graphic designer because then it kind of limits it down. But in reality, do I really do that much graphic design
at this point, right? But thank you for being here. I know you were a little hesitant. It's not your I know you were a little.
You didn't tell me I'm the first one.
You're the very first one.
Wow.
Yeah, there was a few that had to get rescheduled, so you're the very first one. But like I was saying, I've known you, the people that I'm going to interview, I've known you the longest. Yeah. The other guy, which...
Was 97 when you started?
97 is when I started. I thought it was 95.
Yeah, I thought you were earlier than that.
But it was 97 because I was... Wait, let's do math.
I feel like it was like maybe 96.
It could have been 96. Well, when did you start?
I started Mossimo in 94.
Oh, so you were there for a few years already.
I was there, for like 2 years.
Oh, so maybe 96 then.
I feel like it was 96 because, because we hired you because Mel quit the first time.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then he came back. Because he quit. That was during the interview. He said someone left, so they needed to fill it. So I came in, but Mel was there when I got there.
Yeah, because then he came back. We had already hired you, so.
Why did he quit?
I don't know. It was a weird... I think he had been there for a while, and I think that he was feeling kind of bored, and, you know, he was just kind of doing the same thing, and I think he didn't realize how lucky he had it. And then when he did leave, he realized that I think he also missed the, you know, we had a really interesting crew.
Yeah.
And I think he missed that sort of family atmosphere.
Creativeness. Yeah. Oh, family, yeah.
I think that was really what he missed, because he could, he can design anytime. But
I don't know if he'll be able to hear the airplanes, maybe. Yeah, but then they probably lured him back as well, right?
I think so.
With the little extra cash.
And I think that he had expressed interest to possibly come back, and I think that Moss was like, yeah, bring him back.
Oh, how funny.
Yeah, and
yeah, because he was doing all the shirts.
Yeah, I mean, he was the moneymaker.
Yeah. Yeah, at that time, I don't know how many shirts they were selling, but it was millions, right?
Yeah, like so many units.
Yeah, because Mossimo at that time was like one of the biggest action sports. Was it action sports? It started off at action sports, and then it got into more.
Yeah, I think fashion. That was the genre that that Mossimo was sort of fit into. Action sports sort of became a buzzword a little bit later on when things like snowboarding and stuff like that started to become bigger. But he was, because Mossimo started with like volleyball shorts, you know, and I think by the time that you came, when I came in, he was already starting to transition into trying to be more of a fashion brand. That's how I kind of wiggled my way in there. I think that's kind of why Moss had hired me.
That's right. Well, so we'll get into that too, because I wrote that down. I wanted to know, because you went to Art Center and then he grabbed you from Art Center, from your graduating. Or your
sort of,
or your designer show and like the stuff that he saw.
So,
well, let's get into that afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. Cause that I want to know it. Cause I kind of know, but not really. Really quick. So we're in Orange County now, but you grew up in Orange County.
I did.
Right. And you were saying that you.
So my formative years. So I was born in New York, but my parents.
Oh, were you really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Upstate New York. But my parents moved to, Garden Grove when I was about 3.
Okay.
So I don't remember any of New York. And I was in Garden Grove. I grew up in Garden Grove up until sophomore year in high school. And then my parents decided to move from Garden Grove to Irvine. And then I spent, you know, those last 3 years of high school, which seemed like an eternity at the time.
When you went to Irvine, did you know people already?
I did.
So you had friends.
Yeah.
Ready to go.
We had friends. When I was in, all growing up, we went to this Taiwanese Christian church that was based out in Garden Grove area. And a lot of the other people that were there, a lot of my friends, they happened to live in Irvine.
Okay.
And so that's why my parents kind of, I think they wanted a new house too.
Yeah.
But they were like, you know, Irvine had a better school district and everything. Yeah. And so they wanted to move. And then I had some friends already. So they, you know, figured it'd be a good thing.
It's like the friends that I met in high school, it was a lot of Filipinos, but they all, like I met one family, but then I met a lot of other friends through there, but it was because of the church.
Yeah.
They all were like a church group.
Yeah.
So I guess they would all see each other. So if you knew one family, you would know the next.
Yeah.
So
and the Taiwanese community here in Orange County and kind of California is at the time was pretty tight knit. And especially if you had, my parents had come from a church in Taiwan. And so coming to America and everything, they quickly found others. Yeah. And it's like everybody kind of knew everybody. And it was
it the same church?
Yeah.
Like
similar. Oh, yeah.
That's cool.
And
it makes it easy.
And so, yeah, they already knew like a lot of people, even friends. And then the college that they went to in Taiwan was also kind of a small, tight knit community. So they knew a lot of people already here.
When did they make their way here?
In the late 60s, they came here for school.
So you're first gen then?
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, they came from school.
Yeah. So they went to, both my parents went to, I think it's called like National Taiwan University, which is like I guess one of the best, I don't know, colleges out there in Taiwan.
Ooh,
and then they, for some reason, decided to come to America, like a lot of people did, you know, at that time. And they didn't really know where to go. So they just sort of applied to a whole bunch of colleges in the US, and whoever would give them a scholarship, they kind of like, okay, well, that's where we'll go. Yeah. And it turned out that they, at least I think my mom got the scholarship first, then she got it in North Texas.
Oh.
And cool. So they both went there and they finished
Texas.
Yeah. Both, so my dad finished his master's in Texas.
So they were already married or together before they moved out here.
Yes.
Oh, cool.
And then my dad got his first job at IBM, I believe, and they were out of upstate New York.
So you guys, so they moved over there.
Yeah. And then at some point my mom's sister moved to California, and then my mom kind of wanted to be closer to her. So then my dad was able to transfer to and get another jobs at another aerospace type company out here in, I think it was Long Beach originally. That's why they moved to Garden Grove.
Did you ever know if they ever had a desire to move back to New York?
No. I think they really liked it here. Yeah.
Well, weather, right?
Yeah, they really liked it here. And again, like family was here already, and they were very comfortable with the California weather and everything.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So then after that, so when you were in a high school, when did you feel like, because I'm assuming you went to Art Center right after high school.
So,
were you already like,
close
thinking about stuff like creative wise?
So I was always into art, you know, but art's like art, right? And it wasn't until high school, and it actually wasn't until I moved to Irvine that I think the word design sort of came into my consciousness. I think it started with a lot of my girlfriends at the time were all into that brand Esprit in the 80s, and so we'd go to the mall and like, you know, they would be buying the stuff. And I was just so fascinated with the packaging, the hang tags and everything, because the iconic Esprit logo that.
I do remember you said you had a Esprit banner hanging up.
So I was, it was weird because I was so obsessed with that logo.
And it was like the three lines, right?
Yeah, for the E, designed by John Casado. But it. So that's like 86-ish, 87. I was just so obsessed with the thing about Esprit was they were like one of the first brands to sort of bring that branding experience. Like branding has always been around, but it's mainly in the corporate world. But for a fashion brand to sort of infuse that branding as such a powerful part of their identity. And it was everything. It was like, the stores
look like the tags.
It's like everything tied in. And it was just really joyful. And part of that whole Memphis Milano design that people associate so much with the 80s and 90s, you know, geometric patterns and shapes and just bold, bright colors. It was funny because obviously I didn't have any of the clothes because it was primarily women's. But I just loved everything else. So I would tell my friends, like, save your hang tags, save your stickers, save your bags, save your boxes, and just give them to me. And they'd be like, okay. So then I started collecting all of that. And
funny.
Yeah, it just, so then that sort of started to
pique my interest. Do you still have any of that?
I have all of it.
I have all of it.
It makes me.
Okay, so then that started to pique your interest.
Yeah, and then a lot of my friends were getting into yearbook. So I joined yearbook,
Okay, yeah.
And I had, so there was a classmate that was in charge, the editor of the yearbook. And so because I was into art, I sort of got sent to handle the layout and stuff like that. She was like hardcore. She was really smart and really motivated. And
The editor.
And she had this vision for what she wanted the yearbook to look like. And she brought me once into the library. And at the library, they had these Graphis design annuals, which I had never seen before. Yeah. And she's like, I've seen this. I want this kind of look. And I'm just like looking at this annual and like seeing all these amazing designs documented. I'm like, what is this?
Yeah. It's all brand new.
Yeah. And it was really cool. And then I had a teacher, the aide in art class in high school, she sort of noticed that I was kind of having an interest in this sort of thing. And she was actually a graphic designer. So she took me aside one day in art class and she's like, have you thought about like what you want to do when you graduate high school? And I was like, no, I don't know. Like, go to art school, I guess. And she's like, I think you might be good going into graphic design, studying graphic design. And I'm like, I don't really understand what that is, yeah. You know? And so she sort of mentored me and showed me kind of like the things that a graphic designer could do. And it all kind of made sense because then suddenly all the things that I was liking about Esprit and I was also starting to get really into some cool magazines like Interview Magazine.
Yeah.
And I would see all these fashion ads and, you know, and obviously all my friends went to the mall. So just seeing all of the stuff that was happening in the mall and in fashion, just I was like, I want to do something in this world. And so she encouraged me to kind of look into that. And so
this was all pre computers too, right?
Yes. So everything was all like press layouts. Type.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Letter set.
Yeah. And so
Amberlith.
So Ruby looking Lith. At schools. No, I never did the Amberlith thing. I never got or that Ruby? Far. No, I never had Ooh, to do that.
Wow, really?
Yeah, I never had to do that.
Only had one job with that.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I remember we had a little bit of that in the yearbook, but not like you just sort of sent it off and the yearbook company sort of handled it. But it was a lot of like cut and paste and like tape and stuff. Yeah. And I was looking into art schools. My parents were completely dead set against it because they wanted me to get like a real job.
Real job.
And like but I but like they it was a struggle to get them to accept that I wanted to go to art school. So but then they're like, okay, well, if you're gonna go to art school, then you need to go to the best art school. Typical Asian thing, right? And so art center, so we went, I remember we went a couple times to go see, like we went to go see Cal Arts, we went to go see Otis, and we went to go see Art Center. And the tour, Otis, you know, like Otis isn't in the best area.
Yeah.
And I remember they were taking us to the tour and there was like, we had to go through this one area and then go into this door. But right in front of the door, there was like a bum sleeping in front of the door. And my mom was just like, no,
yep.
immediately no.
You will not be going here.
Yeah. And then we went to Art Center. And then, you know, if you've been to Art Center, you go through that curve and then you see the beautiful black, you know, it's all like fancy. And she's like, okay, this is better.
Yeah, it's a huge difference.
I didn't really understand how hardcore you have to be serious about design to go to Art Center. Art Center is not like an art school, your typical art school. Yeah. It's very concentrated in whatever field you decide to go to. So after knowing that I wanted to go to Art Center, I kind of threw together my portfolio, not knowing anything. And I had a couple designy things, but most of it was just like stupid art projects from high school.
Was there any, did you include any of your yearbook stuff?
Like, yeah, I did. I included like the cover and stuff like that. And I got rejected.
Oh, you did?
When I applied, and I was devastated. I was so like upset and mad and miraculously there was a counselor that I was able to talk to there, and they're like, you have a lot of talent, but you need to show that you're really interested in design. And so I went back, and
this was the counselor at Art Center.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
And yeah, it was incredibly generous because I didn't know what to do. I thought, oh, okay, well, screw that. I'll go to UCI or whatever. and they just said, you just need to have more examples of graphic design. And I was like, oh, okay. So I spent, I don't know, like maybe, so I had missed that fall quarter to apply. They said the next quarter will be spring. So you have from now until then to reapply.
Oh, so you didn't have to wait a whole year?
No.
Oh,
yeah. Okay. So I went and just, I, you know, went back to those graffiti annuals and just was like, okay, well, what do I need? Like, okay, I'm going to do like a menu design. I'm going to do like, and so I just made all these things by myself and it was.
And then how did you make it? What were you creating it on? Was it a,
it was
like
all,
layout, like page layout? Like
it was color stick? Copier, color copier, press down type. And like spray glue and cut and paste stuff. Yeah, I shot everything with my instant camera. took it to like you know,
1 hour
like,
photo.
Yeah, and would take that to the color copier and enlarge it and then like glue it on. Yeah. And I tricks. Just took photos of everything and so then by when I applied for the spring, I got in.
Okay.
Yeah.
And now, did they remember you? Like, oh, welcome back, John. Like, let's take a look. Or was it a brand new?
No. At the time, the guy that was in charge of the graphics department. Yeah, he remembered me. Oh, that's cool. And but it was just funny because like I didn't really know what I was getting myself into because again I was saying it's hardcore. And when I got to Art Center, thinking that so all my other friends had started school, they were like at UCLA and whatever. And then when I got then, I'm 18 and everybody's like so much older than me. And so like the median age at that time was like 23 because most people went to school for a couple of years and then decided that they wanted to concentrate on graphic design and then transferred. So most of the people at Art Center at the time were transferred. They had very few straight from high school unless you took their Saturday high course.
Yeah, I remember
or something.
Those. Yeah. I
didn't do that. Yeah. I didn't even know about it.
Heard about that afterwards.
Yeah. And so when I got in, it was like, it was totally baptism by fire because it's like all of my classmates were already so like advanced adults,
But then that's a good way to like jump into everything because now you're just learning from people that have already experienced.
And at the same time, I knew this is what I wanted to do. Yeah. So I didn't get too hung up on that.
So when you were there, did you see the other departments? Like, oh, maybe I'll go into like photography.
Oh yeah, I was obsessed with the going into the photo lab and seeing what was happening in the photo lab. They started a computer lab at that point, but there wasn't a whole lot like going on at that point.
It was probably on the little classics, right?
Yeah, and it was
'91.
Yeah, and it was mostly like, I don't know what they were doing. At the time, the big thing, by the time I graduated, the big thing was multimedia. Remember multimedia? CD-ROMs.
It was called Multimedia Creator. Is that the?
I don't know, but.
And then you would have to like interacted like program buttons and I was all into that.
Yeah. And I wasn't really into that. I knew all the way through that I wanted to do something somehow related to the fashion world. Because it was the most exciting to me. And I knew that was something that I wanted to. I wanted to be basically what Esprit was doing. Like I wanted to be work at Esprit, essentially.
But then now that you say that, because there were Esprit, what I remember was really bold colors, a lot of different colors. And that's a lot of your design now.
Esprit has always been the kind of bar for me. Everything that I've always wanted to do kind of went back to that. And it's funny because, I owe a lot of that. So I owe a lot of that to Tomotsuyagi, who was the creative director from Esprit. That he was the second one. The first one was John Casado, who made the graphics. And he really set the tone with the catalogs and the look and everything. And he left at like 84 or something like that, or 83. And then Tomotsuyagi got hired and he kind of took it further. And he's the one who kind of did all the packaging that was really cool and everything. And Esprit was really smart because they came out with books to document all of their stuff while they were still a big brand, which is interesting. Yeah. So
I don't think I've ever seen those.
Oh, they're amazing.
So it's like a movie behind the scenes book, but
kind of. And they knew that their design was good.
Yeah, yeah.
And so they apparently, from what I understand now, they came out with these books to sort of give to their buyers and stuff as something in between because they were growing so much that they couldn't keep doing all of these catalog shoots that but they needed to give them something. So they just kind of documented all of the stuff that was happening because Esprit was so much about the culture.
Yeah.
And again, that was a new thing for brands. And they really promoted this lifestyle as part of their whole thing. And so they had these books and they are also one of the first brands to really like take the employees and make them the models. So it was like real. Authenticness, this whole idea of being authentic. And they were like one of the first to really do that. And so I quickly learned the name Tomotsuyagi because they would credit him and show him in these books and things. And I remember getting the books just those were my Bibles.
And back then, like you didn't have internet. So if you got a book, you would read it from cover to cover.
Oh, and totally.
Like multiple times.
Yeah.
And then you would start to read all the little, like, it's like having an album where you read the liner notes and then you start to know all the lyrics.
And well, see and who's back the then, producers. You know, it's just like mail order catalogs, yeah. right? And so, yeah. And Esprit was, he had these catalogs that came out all the time and you've got on the mailing list, you know, and then I just poured over it and just sort of that really set the foundation for my design.
Now, do you think, now that you said they would fill in these in-between gaps, do you think you've done that? Is that why you've kind of done your magazines in between?
I've done the magazines because that is, well, I've always loved editorial, but I do that because I think that it's really important to foster your own projects outside of client work.
Yeah.
Because, you know, as you know, we it's somehow kind of ended up in this sort of kids space, you know, doing a lot of work yeah. for these kind of big toy brands or kid related lifestyle brands. And, you know, I'm not a kid, so you need to do something for yourself, you
yeah,
know?
Yeah.
And so these magazines were more of a way to, plus, you know, when you're an agency, you're only as good as the last project
yeah.
or as a freelancer or whatever, yeah, yeah. you're only as good as what you can show. And when you're working with these clients that have, you know, NDAs and all these projects that you can't show any of the work that you're doing.
That's
so you
point.
Need to have something to show to solicit if you're trying to get more
work. And then it's
work.
Also good, like say like, oh, well, do you work on this subject? And you're like, well, no, I did this in the last project. And they're like, well, yeah, but that's not related at all.
So, right.
Yeah.
So to kind of foster your own creative projects allows you to do what you want to do on your own terms. And that's what these magazines that we were doing yeah. kind of let us do. We could do our own photo shoots. We could do the type of designs that we wanted to do and you know, kind of use that to be a calling card, you yeah. know, for whatever. And
yeah,
not worry about like anybody getting mad that we're showing it or whatever. It's kind of like kind of non-offensive to anybody, you know.
Okay, so going back to Art Center, so you're, how many years did you go there?
So Art Center was two and a half years. Yeah, it was, I took one term off because I was out of high school, I didn't have any academic credits. I had a couple transfer because I, when in high school, I got into some weird program that allowed me to do some credits but I didn't have any like humanities credits.
Yeah.
So I couldn't get my degree unless you have those credits. And so they
don't offer that.
So they do, but you have to take an academics only term is what they called it back then. And so you couldn't take any the design yeah. classes. And so I took an academics only term. And so that was like a joke because their humanities things were so not like one of them was like, basically I watched movies that, and then just had to like, write like a report on like the movies that I saw. Like
nice critique.
And then the best one was, I don't know. And I don't know how this translates to a humanities like thing, but like we went and toured multiple famous design. It was the best class. It was multiple design centric landmarks in LA. So went to like the Frank Lloyd Wright House and all of these like famous LA landmarks. And then the last part of it, because the guy that was leading it was a location scout mm-hmm. for TV shows and stuff. And so
his all the spots.
Yeah. So yeah. he knew everywhere to go. And so he took us along. And then the last part of the class, he had to location scout for 90210, which was happening at the time. It had just kind of started their first season and they were going into the second season. And it was the first time they were doing the summer episode, which at the time, no TV shows showed anything in the yeah. summer. And so 90210 kind of broke new ground because they were going to have new episodes in the summer. And it kind of coincided with us in the class. And so he hired the class as extras to be part of that thing. So I'm in an episode of 90210. Yeah. That's my claim to fame. No. I'm in the background.
When you watched it, did you see yourself?
Oh yeah, I did everything I could to be in the shot.
Hello, everybody.
Okay, I did everything I could to try to get in the shot. It was
guy
like
in the back, please stop looking.
Yeah, seriously. When you see like how like I would like laugh obnoxiously to try to get into frame.
Do you still have that?
You can see it online. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The episode is like Castles in the Sand. It's the one where Castles in the Sand. I guess Brenda goes to Paris and she comes back.
I remember that.
And she comes back and Kelly and Dylan had kind of had like a thing.
Yeah,
remember?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they didn't tell Brenda yet. So there's this episode where they just come back. And so they're making there's like at the whatever Malibu Beach Club or whatever, they're having a sandcastle building contest. And so he hired so the characters made their own sandcastle, but we were supposed to make that for them. Like we got hired to build that. Then they had professional sandcastle builders build like the other ones. And then, but the class got hired to build this like cheesy,
that's cool,
like amateur. So what they are building is what we actually built. Yeah.
Now, is that the same that you're walking behind too?
So I'm in like a whole bunch of scenes. I hung out as best as I could to
Did you get paid for it? Or there's
I
like
did. Oh, that's I cool. did. Yeah. It wasn't much. It was, yeah, it wasn't much. But yeah, I did.
That's cool.
It was great. But then that fulfilled my academics. And so incidentally, that.
So you didn't have to do like math or anything?
No. It was so stupid.
What?
I was like, this
I
is
went
awesome.
To the wrong school.
I know. But incidentally, that term, because I couldn't take any academic courses, so I moved back home and I just scheduled all of my classes to like, you know, a couple days in the Greek and then the rest of the day. So I was really bored when I wasn't doing anything at school. And that's when I decided to reach out to Mossimo.
Oh, you reached out.
Yeah. So.
And so, how did you know of Mossimo at the time?
So I was telling you, I was into these fashion magazines. Yeah. And at the time there was Details magazine, which was before it became that men's magazine that we kind of knew in the 90s. Before that, it was this kind of cool New York style, kind of like paper magazine, but like a little bit different. But it was this really kind of more avant-garde, you know, it was a lot of black and white photography. And it was more about the cool people in New York and stuff like that. And Mossimo had an ad in it. And I remember seeing the ad, not knowing anything about Mossimo. I mean, I think I kind of remembered like seeing the logo, but I kind of associated it with like, you know, the volleyball shorts and that whole scene. I was like, that's not my thing. But I noticed on the ad, they said Irvine, California. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And the ad struck me because it was the first time that it was this kind of more fashion-y ad that it was a different type of look for them. And I thought, oh, this is interesting. Maybe they're going in a more fashion direction. Because before that, there was very volleyball and it didn't look fashion-y to me. But this particular ad did in Irvine, California. And so I was like, huh, that's interesting. I I'm bored. Like maybe, so I decided to like look them up and write them a letter. Just to say, hey, I'm a fan.
This is pre-email, right?
This is pre-email. Yeah. So I literally wrote a letter. And at that point, we were able to print stuff out, you know, with the computer, right? So I wrote it. And, you know, I'm in Art Center. So I have at this point, I'm like a couple terms in. So I have a little bit of design experience at this point, right?
Like I'm pro.
Like man. I'm kind of a designer. Yeah. And I wrote this letter and said that I was a fan. Even though I didn't own anything of Mossimo, I didn't really. All I wanted was like
maybe, huge fan over here.
Yeah, all I said, maybe I could get a sticker, send me a sticker, and like that would be cool. So I sent it off and kind of forgot about it. And then one day when I came back home from school, I was checking the messages on answering machine. Yeah. Remember answering machines? And it was Moss on the line. It's like, hey, this is Moss. Hey, Jonathan, this is Moss. I got your letter. You know, if you want to like come down for a tour or something, you know, and
oh, I was shit. Like, wow,
exactly. I was like,
that's really nice though, because for someone because he was still big at that time.
He was getting big, but
for
he
him
was
to, like,
big enough
to take time out of his schedule. Like, hey, here's a fan. They call you up.
So I called back and scheduled with them to, I didn't talk to him. I talked to, you know, whoever and scheduled a tour.
In your letter, what were you talking about?
I literally just said, like, hey. I'm a fan and whatever, and I'm a design student and, like, you know, just, you know, love to, you know, wonder if, just you know, see the office or something. I don't know right. what I wrote. It was just something
really. You weren't looking for a job.
No, not at all. Because I'm still in school.
Yeah, yeah.
And smacked up in the middle of it, too. And so I go over there again thinking maybe I'll just get, like, a sticker. Maybe they'll give me a T-shirt. So that's when I met Jason.
Okay.
And he gave me the tour.
Oh, cool.
And then at the very end of the tour, he brought me in to see Moss. And Moss was like, hey, did you bring your book? And I'm like, no. Yeah, like, was I supposed to? I'm like, but I lived in Irvine. So I was like, I can go and get it. So I ran home, grabbed my portfolio, and came back.
Like within like an hour or something.
Yeah. And he looked at me and he's like, cool. And then, and I showed him. So it was interesting because going back to magazines, when I was in school, I also made a magazine. I made a little zine, and that it was just this total photocopied Xerox thing. And anyway, so at the end of the, that was kind of in there. And so at the part, at the end of the thing, he's like, you know, I don't know if we have, we're not really hiring, but you know, like, if you know, let's keep in touch. And I said, okay, cool. Because of the academics only term, Art Center had offered at the time, they don't have it anymore, but they had Art Center Europe campus. And so I decided, since I'm going to take a break, I might as well take a bigger break and then go from there. And after my academics only, go to Europe and go to the Art Center Europe campus and transfer to Art Center Europe. Yeah.
Oh, cool.
So I was telling him that. Like, you know, cool. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I'm actually like, going to go to Europe after this. Yeah. So, you know, thanks again. But that experience obviously stuck with me. Yeah. So by the time I came back and graduated, it was time to like look for a job, right? And Art Center had on-campus interviews. And Neiman Marcus was one of the brands that they brought in. So I interviewed with them. And they, you know, I got pretty far into it. They flew me out to Dallas. And they were looking to hire to do catalog, to hire people to do the catalog. And I had a good friend of mine that was also got Perella out there too. And so they offered me the position to do catalog. It wasn't for their fancy, the book is what they call it. It wasn't for that. It was for their like
just catalog,
normal plain mailer. Catalog. Yeah, which the lady at Neiman Marcus was like, okay, I kind of know that you want to do the book, but like, get in here and we could probably transfer you at some point. So I had to make a decision. Do I want to do it? So
where were they located?
Dallas.
Dallas. Okay.
Yeah. So, but right before that, I was like, I'm going to reach out to Moss again and see if he even remembers me.
It had been like maybe a year and a half. Okay. So quite some time.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not like a month.
Not like a month. No, it'd been like at least a year.
And you hadn't talked to him during the whole time. Okay.
No. So then I just wrote back again and I said, hey, you know, I came, you know, you were really kind to show me and like I'm going out of school now and, you know, I'm out of school. Like, you know, I'm going to be graduating soon. Yeah. And I'd love to, you know, maybe show you my book or whatever at this point. And he let me come back. And
you had your book this time?
I had my book this time. And again, so I had this magazine and he really liked the zine. Like the normal graphic design stuff was like, hey, yeah, whatever. But the zine was something that he was really interested in. He's like, you know, again, like, I don't know that we're hiring, but like, I want you to make this zine or a zine for our in-house, just for the company. I got brought in. So he's like, you know, it'll be kind of like a part-time thing and maybe we can kind of like, find a place for you afterward. So I got brought in to make this sort of like, basically like an in-house newsletter, but like it would be cooler because it was going to be printed and more like a little magazine. And so that was really what sold, got me the job. Not any of my, like all this Art Center money was sent to do this. It was this little underground thing that I did on the side. That was the thing that really got me my job.
What was the art department before you got there?
So it was Mel. Scott.
Okay, so they were
and
first.
And Fred.
Fred.
Yeah.
Oh, so Fred worked there.
Fred Hild.
Yeah.
Fred Hild.
Oh no, Fred.
Fred tall. Hild was no, he's not tall. Fred Hild was the art director for Mossimo.
Okay.
At the time.
Yeah. And then he, when I got there, he had already left.
Yeah. Because I was the art director at that point. Ah,
so he took his spot. So at what point did they say, hey, John, why don't you come in for like a full time?
Yeah. It was like maybe after the first zine that I made for them. And then they were kind of like, hey, yeah, we can make a space for you.
So you worked with Fred for a while?
A little bit. Yeah.
Then you.
There was drama. That was not my fault. It was not intentional. But yeah, through a series of very odd events, then Fred left, and then it was me, Mel, and Scott on our own. For a while.
So only three people for that art department was pretty. That's a lot of work, though. Still, right?
And the majority of it at the time was Mel, because the t-shirt graphics. He was the driving force for it. And I got brought in to handle, I sort of found my place very quickly. It was like, I can do all the other stuff, all the collateral, all of the hang tags, all of that other stuff. And and then I was really, because this was like a perfect opportunity to me, that's when I started hanging out with Jason in the marketing department. Cause I was like, this is what I'm into. Like I wanted to see how you guys are doing the fashion campaigns and all of that. And Moss quickly picked up on my interest in fashion, which was different for him because Fred was not interested in that.
Yeah.
And he had a very clear line drawn because I think he had a bad experience with Moss. Mm-hmm. He had done an ad and Moss hated it. And then I think Fred was really offended by that. Mm-hmm. And so he didn't want to have anything to do with the marketing department. Whereas I was like, they need to go hand in hand.
Yeah.
You know, fashion, all your image ties together.
And then Scott was more production.
Yes. Yeah. He kind of handled the production and went to see, make sure that everything was done correctly. And so then when Mel left, then Moss freaked out because suddenly his cash cow was gone and he was worried that I was going to leave because then that would just leave Scott. And
were you going to leave? Were you planning to?
No, I didn't even know Mel was leaving.
Oh,
he didn't tell us.
Oh, he just left.
He just left. He was just like one day, hey guys, you know, I'm out. And we're like, what?
For those of you who don't know, Mel was recently passed, but he was an extremely talented
illustrator.
And yeah. I had heard of Mel just through flyers, through party flyers. I had seen flyers early on. And then when I met him, I was like, you're that dude. You're the dude who does the flyers. And everyone knew that there was this guy who could just do amazing illustrations. And it was like, I don't know how this guy's drawing these flyers.
They look like photos. It was so weird. Almost.
So back then it was all vector art. But for back then, I mean, that was huge.
Yeah. And he just was so incredible. And he was so welcoming.
He was a workhorse, yeah.
Yeah. He was so welcoming to me when I started there because he was really happy to have another creative person that was also interested in fashion and the same things. To sort of bounce things off of. And we got along great until he quit. Then I was a little shocked because I was like, you didn't tell me. But it was an opportune moment for me because then Moss was immediately called me into his office when he found out that Mel quit and was just like, you know, Mel's leaving, like you're not leaving too. And I'm like, well, no, but you got to like, if I'm going to be taking over these things, there needs to be some changes. And so that's when I took that opportunity to really step up and
become the art director,
which wasn't my plan in any way, but I was like,
But to think about it, if you're fresh out of school, now you're in charge of like this $1 million company.
That was baptism by fire because then suddenly I had, but you know, it didn't faze me back then. I was just like, let's just go, know? And again, it was like, I was finally able to sort of live my Esprit fantasy, you know, and really kind of do whatever I wanted to do. And Moss was great in that he really respected my design and trusted me to do my thing, you know, and he gave me all the freedom to kind of, you know, do, obviously he had his say, but we had a good vibe going for, you know, for that run. And I really,
how long were you there?
I was there for four, because I left in 98 and I came in 94. So I was like 4 years.
4 years.
Yeah.
But that was a lot. That was a big was body
a,
of work.
There was a lot of stuff happening in that. It was a very crazy ride.
Yeah. So then I met you, which brings me to when I met you.
Yeah. So when Mel left, we needed another illustrator and I was not an illustrator. I could do designs, but I couldn't draw little characters. So we needed to find another illustrator to take to kind of take up that illustration, the character thing, because the characters were what was selling.
Yeah.
So that's when we started to look for new designers, and that's when we found you. And we were like, okay, you can do characters.
And I found that ad through the newspaper.
Yeah,
it was a tiny, it was like a little ad, and it said Mossimo, and I was like, what? They're hiring?
Yeah, I was like, you know, working with the HR department, like, we need to, like, all the art schools, all the everything, you know, like whatever we can throw out there. And we got a ton of applications, yeah. But very few people could really do characters.
Yeah, we came in, and then I still remember I came in. So at that time, you'd always get these jobs and like, okay, dress up in my suit. Okay, look nice. And then I went there and I was like, well, I don't know what to wear. Like it's Mossimo. It's like more casual. I was like, well, I'm still going to wear a suit. So I went and I wore my suit, and then, you know, like a year later or something, you were telling me like, why'd you wear a suit? You came into the interview in a suit. And I was like, I don't know. I was trying to look professional. But so I saw the ad, and then it said it needed to do care. Or I met with you guys, or I met with Scott, and they said, oh, can you do these characters? Like, cause I sent some stuff in, and they said, yeah. They go, here, come back. Here's the thing, and come back with these characters. So then I went out that had to give them like the next day. So I went out to the bookstore, and I forgot the name of that book. It was a book that had like all the flyers, all the European flyers in it. Uh-huh. So I was just going around like, okay, how do you do this halftone? Like, you know, the halftone effect. And like, I'm going to draw a character like this. So I try to like mimic that as much as possible. And then I was already familiar with all the Mossimo stuff. So, and I already knew Mel, his drawings. So I was like, okay, I was just like this all night. Like, and then I had a job at the Yellow Pages at the time. That's where I was working at Yellow Pages. And so then I was like, oh, please let me get this job. Like I want out of this job so bad. And then I remember when I got hired, I was like, man, yeah. Which was a huge turning point for my career wise. That was like my first
design.
Like, yeah. My first design job.
Yeah.
And it was just like, oh, this is cool. But when I met you, like you looked like you had it handled. Like all the design, everything was like really nice. Everything was coherent. And that was like when I first saw everything, I was like, wow, this is like what design does. And like, oh wow, you must be so old and so experienced.
Yeah, whatever.
I thought you had been there for, I don't know, like 5-10 years.
No, I mean,
it's a different level because I came from like illustration, graffiti, and then it was like, yeah. Oh, this is different. Like, so
yeah. Like, and cool. Again, it was like, it was probably my whole Mossimo experience was probably, you know, it's something that I definitely am so grateful that I had, because I got to live out my fashion brand fantasy, in a really supportive environment, and quickly able to learn the ins and outs without, you know, and have some time to really learn it, yeah. You know,
and you had a nice budget behind it.
Decent. Yeah. Yeah. And until it wasn't, you know, but
one project we did, it was really expensive. We were spending, I was in charge of like making the bags. And then the shopping bags were coming out to like $5.
Oh my God. Yeah. Like we were a little crazy, and everything was like metallic inks.
huge shopping bags, all huge metallic.
Metallic inks, totally like oversized, thick cardboard.
Yeah.
Really nice finishes. I still have all of those too.
Do you?
Yeah. I saved everything.
I think I have flattened versions.
But of it. Like, yeah. It was just out of hand, but it was great. It was a time when you could do that.
Yeah.
And again, Moss loved it. And you know, we won design awards for it. And, but it was great. The family at Mossimo was, you know, I still am friends with a lot of the people that worked there, you know, and there was something really nice about that until it got to the point where it started to not be. And then that's when, you know, the culture kind of changed.
Yeah.
And that's when it started to get really depressing because there was a lot of layoffs and things like that.
Yeah.
And that's what ultimately kind of forced me to kind of do J3.
But then, okay, so then being at Mossimo, then you met Jason.
Yes.
And then did you leave or were you let go?
I left. Okay. So Jason and I became really good friends. Jason was the VP of marketing, and we became really good friends. So Mossimo started to hire out, as he's got bigger and bigger, he wanted to get bigger art directors to come and do the campaign. So he was hiring like these art directors that I was like, oh my God, these are the art directors that I like, follow and admire. And he would bring in these, you know, huge photographers and stuff like that. But we had all these licensees, right? So we had the swim licensee, and he didn't care about, they had a budget to do photo shoots as well, right. But it wasn't necessarily going to be part of the main photo shoot for the main line. So he was fine. Back in the day, Jason used to shoot like most of it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when he started to hire more professional photographers, Jason didn't get to shoot as much. And then, but he would let us shoot like the swim stuff.
Now, was Jason, was he a photographer full time or was he like a marketing and did
he was marketing, photos but he on the did side. Photos on the side yeah. And he was all self-taught. Like he didn't go to school or anything. So, we worked really well together because I would art direct the shoot and then he would just kind of shoot it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, Mossimo let us kind of do the swim shoots. And we, at one point, we were doing a swim shoot for Mossimo and having so much fun. And, cause it was out of the office and we were away from all of the depressing things that were going on in the office and the politics and Jason was just like, you know, we should do this all the time and not just like these random times we're allowed to shoot. And I'm like, okay. So we had a talk and he was like, we should start our own agency. And I was like, I'm not going to quit my job and just start an agency. I'm like,
we getting paid or not?
Yeah, I was like, Jason, if you find us a client before we start, then I'll quit. And we can do that. Otherwise, I'm not going to leave because I have no reason to, you know. And it wasn't my plan to ever start an agency. If anything, I thought I'd maybe move to New York and try to, you know, work for a bigger brand out there. Mm. But Jason found a client and he's like, we are signed up. And
who was your first client?
It was 26 Red.
26 Red.
Yeah, so it was Andy Crane, who used to work at Mossimo. He had gotten let go. So then he went to work for 26 Red. And because him and Jason were good friends, he was like, we need you guys. And so he brought us in. And so we were doing t-shirts for 26 Red. And then ultimately,
Did 26 Red not have in-house?
They didn't. They had like random freelance
contractors.
And they 26 Red had a problem with keeping a designer, like a main designer. And so
they were in Irvine.
Yeah. Yeah.
I want to say that I did do freelance for them.
Probably.
And the art director kept switching.
Yeah. That was.
Yeah, it was a tiny little shop.
They had a problem keeping a designer, a main designer to lead the line because they would just keep changing. So he needed help, like, because knowing that t-shirts were going to be the cash cow, whether or not the clothes sold. So he was like, oh, let's hire you guys to make t-shirts and stuff.
That's cool.
And so that's how J3 got started doing that. And then we, you know, then consequently were able to do the photo shoot for them. And
so when you guys first started J3, did you guys have a studio or did you just start kind of?
So I started out of my apartment.
Okay.
And that quickly got problematic because like, you know, Jason would come over and because I had the computer.
Yeah.
And, Jason would come up. It's like, you know, we had people are like laying on my bed and like, I'm just like, no, you guys, we can't do this. I need my space, you know? And so then we Jason found the first J3 studio.
In Costa Mesa.
Yeah.
And that was a nice spot. It was huge.
Yeah, it was great. And so then we kind of went from there and just kind of, just started kind of.
And there. How long now has J3?
This year is 25 years.
Is it really 25 years?
It's the 25th.
98. Wow. Yeah.
Crazy.
So that means I didn't meet you 96 then.
I think it was 96.
I want to say 90. Well,
maybe
it had to have been 96, 95.
Yeah.
Wow, 25 years.
Who knew?
And you weren't even planning to do your, like the agency, like you weren't planning to.
That was never kind of part out. Of the, yeah, just kind of like out of necessity. Just like I just didn't want to be in a depressing corporate environment that was like getting more layoffs and just, it was just really depressing.
And did you've always liked, I guess now that you had the studio, did you ever think about like, oh, I'll just move back home and, you know, save money? Or did you like coming in all the time, like having a place to work?
Oh yeah, it definitely loved having, once we had the studio, it was like, because again, it was just like, I didn't want clients coming to my apartment like, you know, Yeah,
it looks a little bit more professional.
Yeah, like, it was nice to, you know, obviously I have a lot of stuff, so it's kind of nice to like dump all that stuff there, you know, and yeah, it was just nice to kind of have this designated space,
yeah,
to do work.
And there's a guy that I'm going to interview next, and his advice, he's an artist too, but I forgot what the exact advice was, but he was telling him, whatever you do, get your own spot, so that way you have to go somewhere and keep everything like art in that room. So when you go there, you know that that's your creative space. He goes, when you have it at home, it's like a mix of a creative mixed with, you know, whatever else is going on. He goes, but if you have that space, either whether it's small or big, he goes, it's a good way just to focus.
Yeah.
And so that friend that I'm in a couple of days, I'm going to interview, he loves it. He has a small little, I think it's like 500 square foot.
Yeah, at this point,
he's there every day.
Yeah, I can't not. I mean, during COVID was weird because then suddenly I started working from home and not necessarily not liking that. Like, it was kind of nice, you know? But ultimately, I do like coming to the office. It's our office. Nice. And everything's here. And this is where you do your work, you know?
Now, how many different... God, brands have you worked on since then?
God, I don't know.
I was trying to write down like the different brands, and I was like, there's too many.
We've
I mean, like the big ones, like you've done Barbie, Mattel.
We've worked, yeah. I mean, we've been lucky to work with not everybody, but we've definitely.
Yeah, you've done a ton. I was going through, I was like, oh, you've done too much. You've done too much. Which, what's one thing I wanted to ask you about the J3 was, what's one of the biggest lessons you've learned since running your business?
I think that the thing that's made us last this long has been relationships. Mm. And I think that that is more important than the actual, obviously you want to do good work,
yeah,
but work can be dictated by so many other factors that are out of your control. And I think the most important thing is that when you do meet a new client or whatever, is to maintain that relationship, because it's the people that are going to be hiring you.
Yeah.
You know, and more, you have better chances getting a job from a referral or from somebody that knows you than cold calling or trying to like get your work out there. It's
100% referrals.
Know. Yeah. Now. And literally we have tried several times to try to solicit ourselves, but it's never really gone anywhere. And it's really been the relationships that I've kept and made through all these years that have brought us to the next thing.
The soliciting worked when, like from like 25, when I was 25 to 30, when I was first freelancing, I would just solicit everything. And then I would get little jobs. But now everything's been referral.
It's all been referral. And it's nicer and that
I don't know
way,
why,
in a way.
Like, I still try to, like, you know, things here and there, I'll still try to reach out with different agencies. And
I think
that's what I hear when I reach out. No.
I think that, you know, having worked at Mossimo, you know, you're bombarded with so much stuff anyway that, you know, to get these random things, it's very easy to get lost and not.
Like, yeah, whatever.
There's just too much noise happening, and usually at the time you're maybe not even in the mindset to be looking for something, you know. And it's really when you are ready, it's like, okay, well, who do I know? It's
a lot easier just to call someone like, hey, do you know anybody that does this?
Yeah.
And then that person will know someone.
Like, exactly.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a
and
lot
then
easier.
It everybody feels better because then there's kind of like a trust there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The thing I want to, you've done a ton of projects, tons, but what project is something that you would like to do that's either like some high fruit, or have you feel like you've done a lot?
I mean,
there's no like holy grail that you're reaching for.
I don't know. It's I've been very fortunate to do a lot of things that I've always wanted to do. But yeah, I mean, there's definitely, you know, I think that at some point I would love to make a book. I've done a few books, but not like a book.
Like
a real book that's like sold in a store.
Oh,
like
an actual book.
Yeah. But I just don't know what that book would be.
Why wouldn't you put your Octopian inside of a bookstore? Do you think there's not a demand for it, or?
Probably not.
But I mean, maybe it would be. You'd put it in there and people would be like, oh, I've never seen this before. It's kind of like where you would see, because these remind me of the old Cinefex magazines,
mm-hmm.
where you would just pick it up and you'd be like, oh, I don't know what's going on. Like, and it would just put like, you know, cool, creative, random stuff in there.
Yeah.
And so that's how I feel this, because there's so much. I was looking through this yesterday and like, like the photos, like everything, like it's so good. Oh, Omnibot.
Yeah. I don't know that to me, like that's like a magazine and
would you ever consider doing a magazine?
I would.
I mean, like a,
real one.
But yeah. What's the, like right now, what's the business of magazines?
See, that's the thing. It's like, it's really hard right now. I think that, it's a struggle to, things have changed when it comes to
I was going
to
ask you about this though, the C-3PO.
Is that Photoshop? It's a combination of Photoshop and we made a mold. I think it's over there somewhere.
Oh, and then you molded C-3PO and kind of like made him dirty and...
I believe we made a mold of C-3PO sitting down out of concrete. And then we Photoshop that into the
I don't know why I didn't notice. I just noticed it yesterday.
Yeah, I think we have it still.
It's like, that's genius.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you about like what inspires you, but like at this point now, like I know you said a whole lot of Esprit, but like at this point, like say you need inspiration, like say you have a project, like where do you go for inspiration? Like it's hard. Like for me, like, it's like, I don't know. Like, I really don't.
Well, usually my projects,
like a theme or
there's a direction that needs to, that we need to do. When it's like a branding situation where I'm trying to come up with something like a direction or something like that. I think there's so many resources now. I mean, Pinterest is great. I usually try to think about, My process is usually I need to think about like what is this world that this thing is about and what are the things that are in that world, and then I start from there and then sort of build out from there.
Mm.
And so it's I think about it as a world, and that's where like mood boards and things like that, like what's the vibe of this thing, whether it be a fashion tear or a color or, you know,
what's usually first on your mood board? Is it a color?
It's usually a photo of something.
Which everything is kind of based off of.
Yeah, and then you can pull the colors from that. But it depends. It always varies. But there's usually like a story that I think of in my head more cinematically. Like, what's this whole thing about, you know? And then I kind of build off of that. That's so cool. Pinterest is great. I love to, I still look at magazines. I think that Instagram. Can you hear that?
That was a loud one.
Yeah. Well, we are by the airport.
Yeah. we're like literally right next to the airport.
But and then travel is always good to see other places, and you catch little things. I also, because I do collect a lot of stuff, it's like, I just look for things that are interesting. And then sometimes when I do have a project, I'll be remembered of like, oh, I'll save this for like, oh, this could be something, in the future. And then
where do you think that collecting comes from? Like you collecting stuff?
I don't know. I'm just a bad,
just a weird
pack rat. I'm an only child. So I always was in my own little world.
Yeah.
You know? And I have always saved stuff.
Did anyone in your family like collect things?
No. My parents were very minimal, I guess, if anything. And there were a couple times where they like, like cleaned out the house or whatever. And I'd be like, you threw that away?
Oh, yeah.
You know, they're like, oh, yeah, you weren't using it.
I was just
it.
Talking to my mom about that. We had this little, I want to buy it. They have it on eBay. It's called the family tree house. And it's like a tree. and then you push the tree and then it pops up.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
There's a little family in there.
Uh-huh.
And we used to play that as kids, but then I don't know, maybe probably like third grade. And then I saw my mom carry it over to our neighbor's house. And then the lady was like, oh, thank you. Thank you. And I was like, what did you do? Like, you just gave away our toy. She goes, well, you guys don't use it. And I was like, but that's our toy. Like, we play with that. She goes, you don't play with it. And I was like, but that's my toy. And I was so, and I was like, oh my God, I can't believe, like, how could she do that?
Yeah.
But that was like one of my first things. Like, oh, that's sad.
Yeah. No, there's like my parents, you know, because they came to the United States in this new world and whatever. And I think that had a big influence. They were always looking at new things. And, you know, our house was never steeped in any sort of tradition. So, you know, in the 70s, my mom was really into like whatever modern 70s design was happening at that point, you know, what in reason, not you know, crazy or anything. And, you know, there's all these pieces now, like, oh my God, like we didn't save that, you know, these vintage 70s modern like things that like, no, we threw that away or we gave it away. I'm like,
no,
yeah, it was so... So sad.
This is gonna, it transitions. I mean, this is totally off, not off topic, but I wanted to talk really quick about AI and how you think it's affecting you, your job, like for like mine, like anything like video related, audio related AI.
I think that we just have to be on top of it.
You feel and like not, it's just a new tool?
I think that you need to treat it as a tool. Yeah. I think that you need to be in the mindset that this is a tool. How can this help you? Because my whole thing has always been being a creative director. And I didn't really, that's why I never did websites. Because I didn't want to get bogged down in, because that technology and everything just kept changing and changing. And I was like, I can't keep up with that. But at the end of the day, it's the vision that drives that.
Yeah.
And I could always find help to execute it.
Yeah.
But what was most important is who's setting the vision. So same thing with AI, you know, if you're just worried about production, like that inevitably is going to be a dead end at some point. But if you're above that, you know, then you'll be okay.
Yeah. It's kind of like story, like stories.
Yes.
Number one story.
Is the story.
And don't care about anything else, like your budget, your or anything else. Like, what's your story? If you have a really good story.
At the end of the day, that's who gets the credit. That's who makes the decisions and has the control. And I think that that's how you kind of have to treat AI. It's like, how do you use it to your advantage and not get bogged down by what it can do? Because ultimately, if you can have something else do it for you, then that's great, you know? And I think that as a creative, that's kind of what you have to focus on is
and most important.
It's going to change. And it's going to, I do think it needs to be regulated because at this point, it's, you know, the references that it's pulling from aren't regulated. And that's a little disturbing because it's pulling people's work without any sort of compensation or anything.
There was a court thing that just happened where they ruled that the AI wasn't, you couldn't copyright the AI artwork. I totally forgot what it was, but that was a recent, like maybe a month ago. So it was kind of like, oh, so no AI art, like you don't own it.
Right.
Like anyone can just take it.
Yeah.
So it's, I'm sure there's going to be another case like, well, I actually did, you know, did the work for this, but
yeah,
it's a long.
It's going to be interesting in the next couple, you know, but then I remember back in the day when Photoshop came out and everybody was scanning everything and there was that whole thing. It's like, well, you're not really shooting anything. You're not creating anything. You're just scanning, you know, and then.
The same thing with like drawing, like vector art. It was like, yeah, but those lines are really clean. That's not you drawing.
Right.
And it's like, but I am drawing.
Yeah. So, you know, ultimately it boils down to, you know, how do you use it and not be afraid of it? Because I think ultimately it's going to become so integrated.
Yeah.
It's already slowly.
And I guess if you got, then you got to make a choice. Like, do I want to be the purist? Like I want to be the oil painter, or do I want to just make sure I can keep creating it?
Right. But ultimately, there will probably be some sort of backlash. You know, it's kind of like, you know, there was a time when illustration kind of went out a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And then it kind of came back. You know, everybody was into photo. And then suddenly now illustration became this like trend, you know, and suddenly handmade things kind of came back, you know, and it was sort of like this revolt against all the like the Y2K plasticky stuff.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, so
that's what someone was saying. I think I forgot who it was, but they were saying that's what they hope AI will bring back the appreciation for made stuff, like people making stuff.
And I think that's
just a tool.
Yeah, it'll come and go. At the end of the day, though, it's still a creative mind that has to drive it.
Yeah, you still need to do something.
And I think that's...
But what happens when that creative mind becomes AI?
Yeah, then...
I guess we have more problems to worry about.
Hopefully we'll be dead by then.
Now, after all this time, after our age now, I know we talked about this before. How do you feel? Like, I always felt...
Tired.
Yeah, tired.
So tired.
Like, say I was 25. I was like, okay, by the time I'm 30, like, I should have made enough money to where I could just, you know, do cool creative projects. And then it's like, well, let me push that to like 35. Let me push that to 40. And now it's like, all right, we're getting older. Like, what happened?
Yeah.
And it's not like we're still able to have a career, which is good.
Yeah. Knock on wood.
But like, how do you feel about that? Because I feel like I knew it was going to be hard, but I didn't realize it was going to be still difficult. I kind of look around. It's like, well, I guess everyone's having it's still difficult for everyone, just even if you have a job.
You know, there are a lot of, I think the thing you have to just, I don't know, the thing that I'm holding on to is just everyone's journey is different. There are people that are our age that are retired and comfortable seems like they did everything right. You know, made all the right decisions and everything just happened for them and they're great, you know, and love that for you. For the rest of us that didn't go down that particular path, I think that it's just, you know, that's the thing. It's like everybody has their own path and it's hard to compare yourself. It's easy to compare yourself to other people's journeys. And I think that you just have to be grateful for what you have and to keep going. Because the good thing about being in this age time frame that we live in is that things can change quite quickly, as we've seen, you know, like within a matter of months, everything, the world can fall apart.
And people can go nuts.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think that, the thing is to keep going. You never know what's going to be, you know, who knows, you might win the lottery tomorrow and
I've already won it a few times.
Well, you know, and then all your suffering will end.
But I guess also, like, I try to think about, it's like, well, okay, you have, like what you were saying, everyone has the same, like, different path. But then I guess at this age, then we can kind of look back and have a little bit of more appreciation for things and a little bit more gratitude. So it's like, thank God, like, I was able to get to here, still being able to do what I wanted to do. Like,
yeah, I definitely have these moments. I mean, again, it's hard because it's very easy to get wrapped up in your own bullshit, you know, but there are times, and especially as you get older and you start, you know, we're getting to the point where we are losing friends that we thought were always going to be there. And for one reason or another, nothing's guaranteed. And so it's kind of a reality check that you're of all the weird professions that are out there, we're very lucky to be able to do what we do and that there is an ability to make a living doing what we do. So, you know, I think it's just, again, like just trying to figure out a way to keep going and not get stuck in doing one thing or being, you know, like just kind of keep slowly pushing forward, whatever that forward just is.
Just keep evolving.
Yeah. I think that as a creative person, luckily we also do have the ability to do that because, there's always something interesting to look at or whatever, and that can inspire something else. And again, things can change quite quickly. It just takes like one thing that turns into another thing that you didn't know was going to happen. Yeah. And, you know.
And I like to think that because we're kind of on our own, doing our own thing, when things do happen, we can adjust a little bit better. Say we were at a job for 25 years and all of a sudden you get laid off and you're like, wait, that wasn't part of the plan.
Exactly.
What am I going to do? I didn't have any backup plan.
Well, and then that's why I was saying, like, it's important to do your own personal things, yeah, because you, to be tied to one company or one thing, that's risky because yeah, nothing lasts forever.
And it's different now, especially because before maybe our parents' age, where you could work at a job
for, yeah, and retire
and be like set and yeah, still be able to afford a lot of things. But now it's like, I've heard of people, like I've seen people, you're about to retire a week before and then they let you go.
Yeah.
And you're like, what?
Yeah.
Like, that was like job security. You're like, what happened? Yeah. Or people lose their pension after working there for
sure. Years. And yeah, I think that in this day and age, the only thing that you can control is your own stuff.
Yeah.
So whether that be, you know, your own projects that you could share on social media, your own channels, you know, it's yeah, like that's important to kind of cultivate, because you don't know what else is going to happen. Yeah. You know, I mean, there's been so many times at J3 where, you know, I thought I did everything right. You know, like we got into working with all of the right companies, but there's no, so, you know, the mentality of like, okay, well, you just need more clients or whatever, yeah, but there's been so many times where no one told me that, I got into all these with all these clients, but none of them are giving us any projects. None of them at the same time, you know, like the gaps, cricket sound, yeah, you know.
Oh, what happened? Oh,
yeah. That's me. You know, and it's just like, okay, well, now what? You know, like, so that theory just totally
yeah, got
thrown out the window, you know. But that's when, you know, for me, luckily, I had been cultivating other channels to get, you know, what I do out there, you know, and, you know.
And been hearing a lot of things like, you know, having different verticals, different pillars of different things you want to do. And I feel like that's super important. Just so like if one thing fails, you have something.
Exactly.
It doesn't have to be drastically different, but no, just so you have.
You need to have something that is not tied to something else. Yeah. And I think that, again, whatever that may be.
Yeah.
And for me, it's always just been, especially over the past, you know, over 10 years, it's just like, I enjoy looking at new things and sharing them, you know? And so when social media came about, it was like the perfect vehicle for that. And, you know, I never took it seriously, but there were a lot of people that did. And now they have like these careers, they're able to build these careers, but then things changed, you know, because then different types of social media kind of came about. Yeah. And then those people that were relying on that thing suddenly had to shift, you know? And
do you ever think about what will be next?
Who knows?
You're right. Like,
you know,
I never predicted.
But as you're saying, at the end of the day, it's still, no matter what platform is out there, as long as your voice and your vision stays true and that you're still cultivating it, yeah, it doesn't matter what platform it's on,
yeah,
you know, and you should be able to build that, your own brand per se,
yeah.
And apply it to whatever. You just have to kind of figure out like what's appropriate for each platform. But ultimately it has to come from you and you need to cultivate that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, yeah, then you'll be stuck with sad things.
Only a lot of sad things. Only two more questions I wanted to cover. Is there anything else that, if you weren't designing, did you ever like, I really wanted to be something like, I wanted to be a chef? Or is there anything else like, if design didn't work out, like say Mossimo didn't work out, Jason didn't get any clients. My life
or whatever, yeah. You know, I don't know. I've always been into art in some sort, you know. As a little kid, I was always drawing. You know, I always had an affinity for art, and it wasn't necessarily that I would, you know, because I feel like art and design are, there's a difference, and design sort of became more practical, but it's still a way to do art, you know. And I think that that's something that as a designer I've been trying to shift, where we go in terms of like, I was always brought up under the school of like, what's best for the client, you know? And
yeah,
when I approach a project, it's always like, what is the best solution for the client? And that whatever that look may be or whatever. But there's other designers and agencies where they do their own thing and people come to them for that thing. So it's sort of like an artist mentality.
Yeah.
And I feel like that is something that I think I've always thought I would love to cultivate more, is what is my, I mean, there is a through line if you look at all, but it's subtle. It's not like, you know, super obvious style per se. And I feel like at this point, it would be nice to sort of figure out what that is and work on that so that in a way.
What do you think that would be? Do you think that would be more like a book? Would it be?
I don't know.
Your own brand?
Yeah, I honestly.
Like, have you ever thought about doing your own brand? Of, I don't know what you would make, but.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Well, it'd be like licensed goods or.
Yeah, maybe. You know, I think that would be a kind of a fun.
But do you ever feel like it's sometimes a little bit harder? Like, okay, I got to make this for myself now. And then it's like, well, what's my direction?
Yeah, I think that's probably something that has kept me from necessarily doing that, especially since I've worked with so many brands and I kind of know the ins and outs of like what it takes, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And is it worth it, you know?
Yeah. How much more tired do you want to be?
Yeah. And at this point, like, really, like, how do I get out is really like.
Yeah. Like, I want to think about the future, but at the same time, I don't, because it's like, how's it going to.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what's going to happen.
I don't know. But I think that it would be great to find a way to end up in a situation where I can still do something creative.
The stuff you like to do.
Yeah. Without needing to.
And have your creative space.
Yeah.
As well. That's cool. And then lastly, what advice would you give future designers or artists? Not to become designers or go be a doctor.
Don't do it. No. Again, like I said before, I think that it's important that whatever you do, make sure that you also find time to make your own creative pursuits a priority. You know, I think that, you know, no matter what kind of job that you end up doing, ideally you want to find a job that that does fit that niche or whatever that you're into. For me, I was very lucky. I knew that I wanted to be in fashion and I was able to find a job that let me be in fashion and do all those things. But not everybody, you know, gets that that opportunity. So, you know, and even working with clients is like, you don't always get the client that, you know, that you want.
Yeah, sometimes you just need the paycheck.
Or there'll be projects that you're just not that into. So to sort of offset that, I think that it's really important to do things for yourself that does foster that creativity, whether it's, you know, whatever hobby or if there's, you know, a niche that you're into, like explore it and don't like not explore it.
How about travel? Do you feel like
travel is huge? Right? And if you can do
it. I wish I traveled a lot more when I was younger. I feel like it would have just learned more. I mean, it's just like you don't. It's just being able to see different cultures, seeing people.
I think that's the most.
And it's even just if like you, the experience
even
itself.
If you can't physically go, I think you know. Look at other. The nice thing about social media is you can travel kind of virtually, right? Yeah. And there are so many people documenting design from other countries and. Like you can, it is important to see how other cultures solve design problems. Yeah. And there's so many websites that are showing great work from all over the world. And I think that it's really important that you get exposed to that because otherwise you're just going to be in your own little bubble and your design is not going to evolve.
Yeah.
You know, and
I always like watching, Michelle and I, we always watch these like dance videos, like hip hop dancing, but you'll see them from different countries.
Yeah.
And like, you know, you see how they dance, but then it's like, oh, I never saw like Korea's take on it. And then it's like, whoa, like this is amazing. Or like a whole different country that you never thought.
And the other countries
they're doing it so well.
Doing it so much better than anything we do here. And because they don't, I think other countries appreciate design. It's so built into the culture way more than we are here.
Yeah.
You know,
especially and, like you go to Japan and everything's. yeah, nicely designed cartoony.
Or Europe, something, yeah. You know, and it's like when you watch those old movies and you see interiors of these European homes and you're like, why are these interiors so much cool? And this is like, you know, 1950 something, you know, and you know, and it's just like, I just think that they probably take it for granted, you know, it's just there, but like, you know, it's inspiring for somebody who hasn't seen that, you know, and even if you can't go internationally, just going to another city, another state and seeing how that city lives, you know, like, you know, being in Southern California, we're very comfortable in our own way, but you know, you go to New York and you're exposed to this totally different way of life, or another city, even in the Midwest, it's just like, you see other things that you're not going to see locally in your own little bubble here.
Where do you want to go next? What's your next travel place? Or where would you like to go? Like, what's one of your, like mine? Like my ultimate one, I want to do a safari.
Oh, yeah.
Like I want to go like Serengeti. And
that'd be great.
You look up prices and it's like, yeah, I'll do that a little bit later.
Yeah. No, like, I mean, my next big plan is to go to Japan for the next Expo. So it's World Expo is in 2025. They're building it now.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. And it's going to be back in Japan. It's the first time they've done it back in Japan.
Oh, it's since like a World Expo. Like,
those big expos. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So.
Oh, I got. Okay. I got to start looking that up.
Yeah. It's 2025. So you got a year to plan. So that's my big one that I really am excited about, because it's like, if you're going to do a World Expo, it needs to be in Japan.
Yeah.
And
where is it at? Tokyo?
It's not in Tokyo. It's outside of Tokyo, but like,
ooh, even better.
But there's an Instagram account for it, and they're showing how they're building it. They already have the mascot.
What month?
It's going to be for like several months.
So, okay.
You know, but
so they have the mascot.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's this weird thing with a bunch of eyes. It's so weird, but it's like so Japan, and it's great. They've been hyping it for a while once they got selected. And they're now building it out. So all the pavilion, they've been announcing like which countries are going to be having pavilions there. I'm really excited about that.
It's like a world. I've never gone to like.
I'm either. Yeah. And you know, like I remember in design school, like, you know, you remember, I remember like seeing things from it, because, you know, some of them are like really like, you know, like New York had one and.
Yeah.
Kind of forget about it, but they've been doing them quite quietly. I feel like maybe it's just an American thing where maybe it doesn't get as much publicity. Yeah, yeah. But, you know, they've been happening for the past couple. I think they stopped during COVID, but then they came back. And then there was a break during the 90s or early 2000s. I think they stopped it, but then they started it up again. And so there's been a few since then. But this Tokyo one is the one that I'm really excited about.
Yeah, we were planning to go back to Japan maybe next year, but. Now it's like, we might as well just put it off for a year. And
yeah, that's when I really want to go. Yeah, it's 2025. So you have a year
cool.
to plan it out.
I think I'm going to be going. All right. So I think we covered everything that I wanted to. That was awesome.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thank you for coming to the studio, even though it's my studio.
Yeah.
All right. Well, you guys can check out all his work at j3productions.com. And he has his Octopian magazine. You can find him on Happy Mundane on Instagram and Pinterest, where he has over 1 million followers. How'd you get 1 million? Oh, was it you just signed up early? Like, what was it?
I don't know exactly.
It's so random. You have 1 million followers. No. Like, damn, that's awesome.
Yeah, but a million isn't, there's people with like 14 million or 20 million.
I have three.
I got onto Pinterest a little bit later. I wasn't part of that first wave, but when I did get on, apparently there weren't many guy blogger or guy pinners, and so it was still small enough that Ben, who is the head of it at the time, he noticed that I was pinning stuff, so he reached out to me and was like, "Hey, they were doing these things called like Pinterviews, they would highlight specific creators." And so he was like, "Hey, would you be interested in doing a Pinterview?" And I'm like, "Sure." Yeah. and then I think after that, I got put on a suggested list. So when you would sign up, they would automatically give you people based on what questions you answered or whatever. And then they would just sort of force you to follow these people, just so you had something to look at when you sign on.
But it's still grown because you had, wait for this airplane. you still had a million, but then I checked and you had like 1 point something million now.
It's always so sort growing. Of, it's always sort of stayed at that. Okay. Yeah. It's always sort of stayed at that.
That's cool.
Once you, yeah. And, the nice thing is that the people that had me didn't unfollow me. So
that's good.
Same thing with Instagram. It's like they didn't unfollow me. Yeah. So,
oh, that's what I was going to ask you before we leave. Happy Mundane. Where'd you come up with the name?
So Happy Mundane.
So you. I saw, I was like, man, that's so perfect.
Happy Mundane came out because at the time, so I started a blog back in 2005 called It's Not Wood. And I was, it was a friend, it was with a friend of mine. And we didn't really know what blogging was, but we both at the time in 2005 was like, that was like the whole, like
that was before social, and like, well,
it was before social media.
YouTube kind of started.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And so, but blogs were like this thing mm-hmm. and it was like blogspot.com
yeah, or whatever.
So there were, I was following a bunch of like these bloggers, design bloggers and stuff. And anyway, so It was a cool time because it was sort of like a way to connect with random people and share things. Yeah. It wasn't about being an influencer or anything. Nobody was monetizing their blogs at that point. And so we started this blog that just documented anything that had fake wood on it. Like faux bois is the term.
Oh, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Faux bois.
Fake wood. Faux bois.
Faux bois.
Learned something. So anything, we were just, I don't know why, it was at that weird time when like, aesthetically, like, you know, I don't know, fake wood was just kind of this novelty thing. Now it's everywhere, but like at the time it was like, ooh. And so anytime we found something, because we would always just like take pictures or whatever and email each other like these, oh, we just saw this or whatever,
post it.
But we thought, oh, let's just document it. And it like weirdly took off. Like people were sending us pictures of stuff that they had seen out there. And the main thing was like, you know, we'd be going to the stores and if we saw something with a fake wood pattern, we would just document it. And but when you're only doing one thing, it's a little limiting. Like we couldn't show, we didn't show anything that was not, that didn't have the fake. It was all just fake wood. It's not wood. Yeah. And, so I started seeing other people posting, you know, other design thingies. And there was like this whole like thing at that point, like Brooklyn was becoming like this big kind of cool, hip place, you know, or it would be like somebody living in San Francisco. And it was like all these people living in these like cool cities, showing these like cool little boutiques or whatever. And I was just like, well, that's cool. But I live in Irvine, you know, which many people consider mundane. But, you know, I'm happy here, you know, and there's things to, I started the blog by kind of showing other things that wasn't necessarily, that are accessible to me. So like I'd go to Kmart, I'd go to Walmart, I'd go to Target, I'd go to, you know, like these stores that were not necessarily in these urban areas, you know, and showcasing, like curating design thingies that I thought was cool. And my whole thing was just that it doesn't really matter. It's not that I didn't like love those cool things. It was just like, you know, for me, it was not where you live. It's how you live.
Yeah.
And I just sort of liked that combination of happy and mundane. And I thought that, you know, that's what I was. Or am. Be living this boring mundane life, living in this track home, you know? Yay.
But you're happy. Well, you take the sometimes. Photos on your phone?
Just on your phone? All of it's on my phone.
No, the photos, like everything's like so perfectly, like all the angles that you capture.
It's like,
it's cool though.
Cropping. Like it. It's called cropping.
Ooh, that's weird. You know? Let me write that one down.
Yeah, it's called cropping. It's good. Yeah, just try it.
All right. So go check that out. Happy Mundane on Instagram. You'll love his cropping. Cool. Well, thank you very much, John. We did an hour and a half. That's
really long. Are they
all still working? Yeah, all the cameras are working still. Perfect. All right. So we can
edit that down.
It's going to be an hour and 32 minutes instead of 35 minutes.
You can cut out a lot.
All right. Thank you very much, John. And check them out, everybody. I got outro music too. This is where we dance. Welcome. Goodbye from the Space Age Mixtape. Woo!
making me itch. Making me itch. Making me itch.